Welcome into this week's edition of the Railsplitter Athletics Report. I'm your host, Adam Haley. We are in the month of March. Last week, we talked about March Madness starting. Today, we're going to continue to talk about March Madness with our guests, Krystal Evans and Josh Schertz on tonight's show. We're going to talk about the South Atlantic Conference tournament that happened in Greenville and the NCAA Southeast Regional tournaments coming up for both those teams. Before we talk about that, let's tell you about some recent results from this within this past week. Women's basketball, they were in Greenville, as we said. They defeated Carson Newman in the semifinals 72-67, ended up losing in the championship game to Wingate 81-61. Men's basketball destroyed Carson Newman in the semifinals 105-62. They also happened to lose, however, in the South Atlantic Conference championship, this time to Queens 75-72. Men's lacrosse went 1-1 on the week, defeating Shorter on the road 15-6, and then losing to Florida Southern at home this past Wednesday 9-7. Women's lacrosse, first two-game winning streak in program history. They defeated Newberry on the road 15-9 for their first conference victory, and then came home to defeat Ursuline 16-7. Men's volleyball split on the week. They were at North Greenville. They lost that one 3-1. They defeated Bryan this past Tuesday at home 3-1. And softball this past Wednesday defeated Bluefield 19-0 and then 8-0 on that particular day. They played UVA Wise on Thursday. However, those results were not available at airtime. We're going to take our first break. When we come back, earlier this week, as we said, we talked to Krystal Evans and Josh Schertz, and you'll hear those conversations when we return right here on the Railsplitter Athletics Report.
Unmatched and unbeatable. Your experience at Danny England Motors comes with the absolute best in offering unmatched quality while delivering an uncommon hands-on process to take your automotive purchase to the next level in customer service and customer expectations. While offering a relaxed, positive environment and a laid-back approach, our drive to surpass the highest of standards in this industry comes nothing short of. Danny England Motors. Come see us today. Automotive excellence starts here.
Established in 1982, Dixie Roofing Incorporated of La Follette has been the industry's leader in commercial roofing throughout Knoxville, Tennessee and surrounding counties for more than 30 years. From medical facilities to office buildings and educational institutions, Dixie Roofing has the experience, expertise, equipment, and know-how to handle roofing needs of any commercial structure, big or small. Dixie Roofing is also on the web at www.dixieroofing.com. Dixie Roofing Incorporated.
Since 1959, Giles Industries has built more than 86,000 quality homes through craftsmanship of team members from the tri-state area. Our clients are extremely important to us, and we're looking for team-oriented family members which allow us to continue that level of excellence known to come with the Giles brand. Our team members receive above-average pay, great health, dental, and vision coverage, a 401k retirement package, and up to 2 weeks paid vacation following the first year of employment. Contact us about joining our Giles Industries family. Giles Industries, quality homes built by family for family.
Juggling my family's schedule is a full-time job. Between school, dance practice, work, there's little time left to worry about much else. That's why I use real-time banking from Home Federal Bank. With real-time banking, I know that when I make a deposit, the money goes straight to my account. No delays, no waiting, no wondering. And I get to focus on what's important.
Real-time deposits, real-time access, real-time banking. From Home Federal Bank, always within reach.
Welcome back into this week's edition of the Railsplitter Athletics Report, now joined alongside by men's basketball coach Josh Schertz. And coach, first off, we're going to talk about last time we talked to you, you were getting ready to travel to Greenville, South Carolina. So we got to talk about the rest of the Southland Conference tournament. Semifinals, you took on arch rival Carson Newman. We had talked last week about when you went to Jefferson City, they found a way to win that one in overtime. And when they came here to Harriet later on, that we really didn't think that was indicative of the Carson Newman team when you all blew them out. Now you go to Greenville, neutral site, and you do it again.
Yep.
You give them Carson Newman the second worst loss in program history.
Yeah, you know, it's one of those nights where we had it happen in sports. You know, it occurs. We probably, the last two times we played Carson Newman, played as well as we could play, shot the ball at an unbelievable clip. I think we were 15 for 22 from three here and 17 for 35 there, and we missed our last six or seven threes, and so, you know, shot at unbelievably high level, you know, and that's obviously, you know, obviously huge, you know, when you're making shots like that. And then I thought defensively we were great, we were active, we flew around, thought we did a good job in the basketball, good job in transition, good job trying to shrink the floor against some great players. I mean, obviously Charles Clark and Sawyer Williams, two of the best ever play in this league, and I've had a great run there at Newman. So. And that being said, you know, I would say probably Carson Newman, you know, didn't play nearly as well as they're capable of. had a rough night shooting the basketball. So when you have two good teams playing and one's at the top of their game and one lays an egg, sometimes you can have scores that are, you know, really, you know, get out of control and are blowouts. But again, not indicative of their team and the type of season they had. And certainly those two games, I mean, we're happy that they fell that way. But Carson's got a really good team, great program, and obviously happy to get the win and advance. But it was certainly unexpected relative to how well we played, and probably again them not being at their best.
Did Luquan take not getting Player of the Year personally? Because his performance in that game just seemed to be the spark plug for your team.
Well, I think, you know, any guy with that's as competitive as Luquan, part of being a great competitor is you have a lot of pride in your performance. And I'm sure he was disappointed. Not that Charles didn't deserve it. Mm-hmm. Charles had a great year. I think Luquan had a great year. Really could have probably gone to either guy, and you could make an argument either way. I'm biased, so, you know, I'm not the wrong person to address it. But I'm sure there was some of that in terms of having pride and trying to make sure that, hey, you know, I didn't get Player of the Year, but I'm gonna show that I'm every bit as good as anybody in the South Atlantic Conference.
You win on Saturday, you move into Sunday, and you end up taking on Bart Lundy in Queens. I think a lot of people, especially I know in the offices of the South Atlantic Conference, are probably really rooting for that matchup. Two top 10 teams going head to head for the South Atlantic Conference title. Unfortunately, the third go around, they get the upper hand. A very close game again, but you all fall.
Yeah, it was obviously disheartening. I think it was, as all three games have been, kind of came down to the end and making some plays, and we just couldn't make enough plays down the stretch. We shot ourselves in the foot. We turned the ball over 12 times in the second half, and against a good team like that, you can't do that. You can't, you know, take away offensive possessions and give them runouts. To Queen's credit, you know, they made some plays down the stretch. We had real trouble with Agusi, real trouble with Camps, and those guys really, I thought those two really controlled the game for them, played great. For us, we just didn't have enough guys play well. We weren't good enough defensively. We struggled, you know, making shots, and so end of the day, it's you're playing, and we knew what was at stake. You know, the region host was at stake, and we had to find a way to get it done and obviously come up just short. So it's tough, but like anything, you know, it's important that when you win, that you learn from it and then you let it go. And when you lose, you got to learn from it and let it go. You know, you can't really stew on these things or celebrate these things too long. It's on to what's next. And for us, you know, we're going to try to bounce back and play well here this week coming up, and we'll head to Charlotte and give it our best shot.
Does Queens do something different that we don't see from any other team that you've seen this season, or is it just the competitiveness between the two teams and how closely they're matched?
Yeah, they don't do. I mean, there's no magic. I mean, they're just a really good team. Early in the year, I thought, you know, and I still think they're a team capable of winning the national championship. I mean, there's no secrets to the hallmarks of really good teams. Mm-hmm. I mean, they're terrific defensively. They've got, obviously, it starts with having great players. They have great players. You can tell they're very committed defensively. They're outstanding on that side of the ball. Offensively, they're unselfish. They take good shots, and you can tell that they're together. You know, they're a tough team and mentally tough, and they hang in there. And I think our guys have a lot of the same characteristics. When we play, it's just two really good teams hooking up and going at it. And all three games have come down. And really, you know, it's very easy to make a case that Queens could be 3-0 against us, or we could be 3-0 against Queens. It's 2-1, and if we're fortunate enough to get to Tuesday, there's a pretty good chance that they'll be the team standing in our way. So, you know, we'll have to find a way to get a little bit better. I have to coach them better. We got to play a little better. But it's very slim margins when we play them.
Southeast Region Tournament for the first time in 3 years is not in Harrogate, Tennessee. Now, you've been a part of teams that's had to go on the road in the Southeast Region. What about your players? Because it's been a few years since we've not actually been in Harrogate. Now, you're going to a site you're used to. You've seen Charlotte before. The team's seen Charlotte before, but it's still not going to be here.
Yeah, it'll be. It's different. I mean, hosting is different. On the road is different. I think that, obviously, it's best to be the one seed, best to have it in your gym, best to have it in your comfort zone. It is what it is. And so we'll have to go on the road and play. I think it's unique in the sense that, you're not as comfortable, your own bed, your own deal, you know, And then the other thing that's unique is really, at least the way it's our bracket is, the first two, you know, the first two games, if we advance past Saturday, are neutral games. So you're not having the crowd support and the stuff that you have here, where, you know, we were getting, you know, 2,000-3,000 fans those first two games, and 4,000 plus for the regional championship. So, and then the last difference, obviously, if you're fortunate enough to get a Tuesday and Queens is there, then you're playing a true road game for the regional title. So it's much more difficult to advance when you are, you know, not the number one seed, but not impossible. We see it every year. You know, I think last year, 5 of the 8 number one seeds advanced. The year before was 6 out of 8. So it's the best route to be the one seed, but it's not the only route.
Talking about Queens going to Tuesday, they got to get through Wingate first, which has been part of their bugaboo.
Yeah.
You all have Pfeiffer, kind of an odd 7 seed in the sense that they were actually co-conference regular season champions in Conference Carolina. They did not play as well in the conference tournament. I think they lost in the semifinals to King, which was almost Cinderella.
Mm-hmm.
You've got a conference champion in the first round as the 7 seed.
Yeah, it's a, I don't know, I haven't studied the bracket like in depth, but how many 7 seeds are 26-4? You know, their record is actually better than ours. You know, so yeah, I mean, they're very good. I've diving into them, they lead the country in a number of categories, lead the country in scoring, lead the country in forcing turnovers, lead the country in steals. They're second in made three-pointers, second in three-pointers attempted. They lost that game to King by 2 points in the semis. You know, co-champions of the regular season. Outstanding basketball team, really unique in the way they play, the way they defend. They've got small guys, they're quick, they drive it, they share the ball. They put great pressure on you from tip to buzzer on offense, on defense. It's very similar to Newberry, but slightly different. But they do a great job, and obviously we struggled, you know, with Newberry this year. So it'll be a tremendous challenge. They're a really good team. I can't imagine there's a better 7 seed sitting out there than Pfeiffer. So we'll have to be ready to play. We'll have to play our best. It's the time of year, most important time of year. You got to play your best basketball, and that starts for us on Saturday.
Now, you know Queens and Wingate, who's the 1-8 matchup. I've got the bracket here. Looking across, you've got Columbus State versus Augusta, UNC Pembroke versus Limestone. Is there a team in particular that you look at that maybe we've not seen this year that could be a team that you may see on Tuesday?
Yeah, well, I mean, you know, you look at Wingate, Queens. They battled 3 times, 4th time playing a team. A lot of familiarity. Augusta had a great year. They were co-champions. Columbus State, you know, gets to the tournament finals. I mean, it's a loaded region. I mean, when Wingate's your 8 seed, that just shows the depth. Atlantic region's great, but I would say the Atlantic region, Southeast region, top to bottom, you know, in terms of the 8 teams in the tournament, I can't imagine there's 2 better regions than that in the NCAA tournament this year.
Got 30 seconds. What's the plan for your team traveling to Charlotte and getting ready for Saturday?
Well, we'll practice here Thursday, leave Thursday night, head down to Charlotte. We got practice in Queens Friday afternoon. We'll practice at a high school after that, just shoot at Queens practice and try to get our guys every game you want to get into with, obviously a clear mind and fresh legs. So we've got to find a way to balance that with preparation, and we'll do our work and be ready to go Saturday at 2:30.
All right, Coach, it's March. This is where you all are used to shining
Absolutely.
As of last year. So good luck this weekend, and we'll hopefully see you in the regional final come Tuesday.
Appreciate it. Thanks, Adam.
Hey, Coach Josh Schertz. We'll be right back with more Railsplitter Athletic Support right after this.
Make K&K Metal Sales your only stop for all your residential and commercial metal building needs. For the past 23 years, K&K Metal Sales has covered the tri-state area with quality custom roofing and siding with many grades, gauges, and colors in stock. If you're looking for complete steel or wood building packages or steel or wood trusses, K&K Metal Sales can help with that, as well as heavy-duty custom carports. Great folks and great prices. Stop by K&K Metal Sales located at 6986 Cumberland Gap Parkway or call 423-869-4261.
From sales to service, online or in person, Anchor Marine of Speedwell, Tennessee is the source for all your boating needs. We carry a wide selection of new and used products and services for Alumacraft, Aquapatio, Hurricane, Polar Craft, Sandpan, and Sweetwater boats and pontoons, as well as a full line of Yamaha Marine engines and Minn Kota trolling motors. From bow to stern, Anchor Marine also carries a wide selection of boating accessories. And if it's service you need, we offer on-site factory-trained technicians that are among the best in East Tennessee. Anchor Marine, 6630 General C.W. Steiner Highway, Speedwell.
At Farm Bureau, we offer more than just insurance. We offer security. Whether you're insuring your automobile, boat, home, or simply buying life insurance, with Farm Bureau, you can rest assured that we have your best interest covered. Our members can also enjoy travel discounts, entertainment discounts, identity theft restoration, and home protection services. Call today at 423-869-8346 or stop by and see Brad Seal at our Harrogate location and find out why Tennessee turns to us for insurance. Experience exceptional service and experience security at Farm Bureau. Commercial, residential, or personal, Lester Signs of Harrogate has you covered with all your sign and graphic needs. From embroidery and screen printing to personalized items, decals, yard signs, logo design, car wraps, digital printing, and sign maintenance, Lester Signs has all your branding needs. Lester Signs is under new ownership and has been serving the tri-state area for more than 25 years. Phone us today to inquire about your commercial sign or marketing specialized needs, or email us at sales@lestersigns.com. Lester Signs, located at 112 Washington Avenue, Harrogate.
Welcome back to the Railsplitter Athletics Report, now joined alongside by women's basketball coach Krystal Evans. And coach, we talked to you last week. You were getting ready to make the trip to Greenville, South Carolina for the second time in program history. We're going to talk about that before we talk about the trip to Columbus, Georgia coming up. Semifinals this past Saturday, you were taking on Carson Newman in a rematch. And once again, it was your team in a very tough, tenacious battle, finding a way to win.
Well, I thought it's really hard to beat a team three times in one season, and so just because you know each other so well, and it's hard to kind of make new adjustments and that sort of thing. But with Carson Newman, it was just obviously they're our biggest rival. But one thing too is a lot of my players and their players played AAU together, played high school ball together, just the ones that are Tennessee girls, so they know each other, mm-hmm. and it just became a really extremely emotional game, and on both sides, and we were very fortunate to pull out with the victory.
Should make mention, we are inside of the Texturn Arena being glowed over by the Jumbotron right now, so that's why you're seeing differences in lighting. Going back though, last year the goal was to get to Greenville. We had talked last week, we got back to Greenville, you wanted to set the tone, wanted to get that first one, get to Sunday, and your team did that.
Yes, I thought we did a great job. I thought we were, our energy going into it was totally different than it was last year. It was more focused, but I feel now it was focused on getting to that championship game, and I just felt like we were so physically fatigued at that game that it also carried over mentally. And that's one thing that we've been talking about the last few days, is just how to remain mentally tough, because everybody's bodies at this point are tired and broken down and bruised and battered and, you know, just totally fatigued. And it's the team that stays mentally tough that's going to, you know, persevere. And, you know, that I think that this was a good lesson for us.
You went into Sunday taking on Wingate, one of the teams that actually had given you a regular season loss, and it was here inside of the Texturn Arena. And easily can say it was in the last seconds. The girl hits a wild shot with tenths of a second left on the clock. They knew going in they had been there before. It was uncharted territory for our team. Wingate was kind of the, okay, we're back on Sunday, let's do what we got to do. And I think we saw that they came out prepared. And like you said, we were tired. Yeah. We put so much into getting to Greenville and getting through Saturday that when it came Sunday, Wingate was just better prepared for that one.
Oh, I agree. I think that, you know, again, that they're experienced. I believe they've been in the championship game three out of the last 4 years, and so their players know what it feels like. And but on the flip side of that, I was telling my players, you know, I thought we did an excellent job last year of resolving ourselves in that locker room after the Anderson loss to come back a better team and not to feel that again. And so now, you know, I was telling the girls that we've got an excellent opportunity to do the exact same thing, take the Wingate loss and resolve ourselves and actually put it into action a week mm-hmm. later, instead of waiting an entire summer and season to really be able to overcome that challenge. And, you know, that's something that's definitely been fueling us, because we have to play back-to-back Friday and Saturday and then again on Monday in this regional tournament. And, you know, I feel like it's actually going to prepare us.
That was one thing I noticed watching the game Sunday. Megan Pittman did not have the game we were expecting. She ends up fouling out of that contest. But it wasn't like when she fouled out, she was on the bench in tears. She was still pumping her team up. Your team still knew at the end of the day, They didn't complete the goal of bringing home the championship, but there was still another day to go. The Sunday did not destroy them. They were like, okay, we've lost this one. Let's get ready. We've got another game to go.
No, they were. I mean, the mentality was totally different. And, you know, with Megan, I mean, the day before, you know, Megan hasn't fouled out throughout the season, and then she fouls out in both games in the tournament. And she played literally, I think, 14 minutes the entire 2 days there in Greenville. And so that's just a whole other topic. But anyhow, we still won against Carson Newman, and we didn't have Megan the majority of the game. Mm-hmm. And I think that, you know, again, that was her mindset. Even when she fouled out in Wingate, she's like, you know, that's okay. We've got enough pieces that we can still get this thing done and move forward. And I just felt like we never really got in the flow of the game. Like I said, we just made a lot of mental errors. But again, when we were in that locker room, I mean, yes, we wanted to win that championship. Everybody wants to win the championship. Mm-hmm. Everybody wants to cut down the nets. And you know, but I was telling the players, I was like, you know, let's not disregard what we have accomplished. Let's not overlook, past what we've already accomplished. You know, and Wingate is a great team. I'm mm-hmm. not taking anything away from them. But they earned that championship in 3 games, and we earned the regular season in 27. And I was telling the girls, like, you know, please put everything in perspective with what we've done, and, you know, let's not get discouraged by this, not one bit, mm-hmm. Because we can definitely come back from this, and the regional championship means so much more. And so, you know, I'm just happy that we've done enough work throughout the season to get that at-large bid and, it, you know, to kind of keep that fire going.
Still, we're going to talk about the tournament in just a second, but we were talking about Megan Pittman, her on the court, her in the bench. We need to talk about her off the court. She is an academic All-American. I had to get that out there. First time in LMU basketball history, men's or women's, that somebody's an academic All-American, and it comes from your team and Megan Pittman.
Well, and also, too, what I don't think a lot of people know about her, she's an academic All-American in the graduate school. Mm-hmm. She's not even, you know, it's not at an undergrad level. And Megan is going to graduate with her master's in 3 semesters while playing basketball.
Wow.
So, you know, I can't brag on her enough. I mean, she's taken, you know, a heavy load every single semester to be able to do that while playing basketball. And she's just, I mean, the kid is just focused, and mm-hmm. she's focused in the classroom. She's focused on the court. She's just that type of person that's, you know, once she sets a goal, she is going to do whatever she can to accomplish it.
Mm-hmm. Now, we have fast forward Friday at noon. You all are now the second ever women's basketball program in the NCAA era here at LMU to go into the NCAA tournament. You got a very difficult draw in Clayton State. They were number 2 in the Southeast region in the final poll, and they somehow dropped to the 6, which I've not understood. And I'm not on the regional committee, so I don't know how it all works out. But
I'm confused myself.
Yeah, I mean, it's go from 2 to 6, and they lost in the semifinals. It's kind of...
I'm right there with you.
But I looked over, and we're going to talk about Clayton State in just a second, but there's teams inside of this regional tournament. You've got King as the 7. You beat them earlier in the year.
Yes.
They're taking on Wingate. We met 3 times this season. Anderson is the 8 seed. You've met them twice in the regular season, split with them. And Lander, who you started off the season with a victory over. So you know a lot of the Southeast region is going to be represented.
Yes, and I mean, they're all great teams, and you know, it's definitely going to be a battle each and every game. But I do think that this is, you know, out of all the teams that we have faced all season long, I do think that these are the best teams in the region. I do think that, like, at least the 8 teams that didn't get to go, I thought that was right and just, mm-hmm. As far as their performance all season long. But, too, you know, I'm telling our players, we deserve to be here, too.
Mm-hmm.
And we're here for a reason. We're among the best for a reason. And, you know, we need to make sure that we're going in with that type of confidence.
Clayton State, you've got Friday, you're the first game, which is probably a good thing because the nerves, I know, are going to be there, but you get it out of the way. You don't have to sit around all day and wait and watch those games. What's the scout on Clayton State so far?
Well, I'll tell you the scout too, but I also told them, you know, we beat Carson Newman at noon mm-hmm. in the first game. I mean, let's just disregard that second game, but we're good for noon. We're good with that schedule, and we're actually happy with it. But Clayton State is a very athletic team. They press a lot. They're probably going to press us for 40 minutes of the game. They're quick. It's going to be kind of a run and gun type of game, and so we've got to do a really good job of slowing them down. They do crash the boards really hard on offense, and we got to do a great job on just, you know, keeping them off the boards. But mainly it's just protecting the paint. Mm-hmm. They are a great group of penetrators on their team, and they're very aggressive with the ball, and so it's really about protecting the paint against dribble penetration and also against rebounding.
I asked Coach Schertz this same question in the first segment. You take a look at the eight teams in the Southeast region. Is there a team that has your mind more than the one you've already got coming up on the first round?
No, because I'm not looking past Clayton State. I'm just kind of, I mean, I think Columbus State obviously is a great team, and we're opposite brackets of them, but right now we're just really focused on Clayton State, and once we get past them, we're gonna have to pass either Wingate or Keene, and then, you know, whoever's left after that, we'll focus on them.
You leave on Wednesday. What's the schedule once you get down to Columbus, Georgia?
Well, we're gonna get there literally at midnight, so resting the girls, and then Thursday we've got practice at 11, and then we've got another practice at another off-site, because the one practice mm-hmm. is really like a shoot-around. And then the plans for Friday is winning.
All right, Coach. Good luck this weekend. Last year, the men's had text to Texas. We're starting it this year. The women are going from Columbus to Columbus.
Yes, that's a good one.
So we're going to be paying attention to them. Again, Friday at noon is tip-off. Again, good luck this weekend.
Thank you.
All right, we'll be right back with more Railsplitter Athletics Report right after this.
It's the Old Town Grill.
The Old Town Grill is a special place where you bring more than family, more than friends. Bring a hearty appetite, because at the Old Town Grill, you'll never walk away hungry. A delicious change from the ordinary. The perfect place to bring the entire family. The best food and plenty of it. Join the fun and treat your appetite to something special.
It's the OTG.
The OTG is the place to be.
Welcome back to the Railsplitter Athletic Report. As we finish off this week's edition, I want to once again thank our guests, Josh Schertz and Krystal Evans, and good luck to both of them and their squads as they move forward in the NCAA Southeast Regional Tournament. The men, again, will be in Charlotte, North Carolina. The women will be in Columbus, Georgia. Let's talk about some things that are coming up, starting with basketball. Women's basketball, again, they tip off Friday at noon against Clayton State. If they win that contest, they'll play the winner of King and Wingate. That'll be Saturday at 5 p.m. Both those games will be on 91.3 FM WLMU. The men, they tip off on Saturday at 2:30 against Pfeiffer. If they win that contest, they'll play either UNC Pembroke or Limestone on Sunday at 5 p.m. Once again, those will be carried by the LMU Sports Network on 91.3 FM WLMU. Baseball's on the road this weekend. They're over in Hickory, North Carolina, taking on Lenoir Ryan for a three-game set. Men's volleyball is at home this weekend, hosting Charleston both on Friday and Saturday. The Friday contest starts at 7 p.m. The Saturday contest starts at 1 p.m. We'll have live video streaming of that one at lmurailsplitters.com. Women's lacrosse and men's lacrosse, they're on the road in a Southland Conference action. The women will be taking on Catawba at noon. The men will be taking on Catawba at 3 p.m. And softball's in Salem, Virginia this weekend. They've got three games on Saturday, taking on University of the Sciences at 10 a.m., West Liberty at 2 p.m., and then Shippensburg at 4 p.m. And again, that's just touching the iceberg of the weekend. A lot of spring sports in action. You can keep up with them. That's baseball, softball, men's and women's lacrosse, men's and women's tennis, golf, bowling. I'm sure I've missed a few of them. All of those, as well as what's going on with men's and women's basketball inside the NCAA tournaments, all that can be found at LMURailsplitters.com. That's going to do it for this week's edition. However, the Railsplitter Athletic Report, I'm your host, Adam Haley. We'll see you next week.